The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to episode 81. Why are you clapping of the Big Scottish Football Podcast?
It's Easter Monday, Stephen.
It is Easter Monday, so that's good. Yeah.
Easter weekend, and I've got the week off. I'm here to do the podcast, but I'm actually got a full week off from doing the breakfast show. And here we are on the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Easter Monday, day after Easter Sunday.
That's how it works generally, yeah.
Yes, and yeah. I had some Easter eggs yesterday and watched a lot of football. So yeah, I'm in a good mood. Apart from the fact, I know those who are not watching on YouTube won't see this, but you can see there.
You've spilt coffee on yourself.
I've spilt a massive dollop of coffee on the jumper that I'm wearing. Look at that. That's horrible.
That'll knock him out.
That's right under my left nipple.
Yeah, it is.
And you can just see it on the telly, which is a pain in the ass. I actually knocked a coffee cup as I was walking through the door. I didn't open up the door far enough and then knocked a coffee cup out my hand.
That's what you get for buying really expensive coffee for no reason.
It's a large cappuccino with an extra shot because I'm buzzing!
Yes. Great. Well, listen, thank you very much for coming along as per usual. It's episode 81, as I mentioned. We have made it to 81 episodes. God knows how, but thank you very much for all your feedback, all your comments. Remember, you should subscribe and you can leave us 5 stars
Please.
In the review as well, because it does help us. So lots and lots of feedback on last week's...
Wait a minute. Can I just talk about the weekend? We talk about the weekend first. I've had a lovely weekend, as I kind of alluded to. Had a great Easter Sunday with the mother-in-law. She came up to the house. We had a lovely roast dinner. Roast pork.
Oh, interesting.
Roast potatoes. No mash. I thought, well, roast dinner, you want a wee bit of mash and a couple of roast potatoes.
Who made it?
My wife.
Right. You could have just said to her.
Yeah, I know, but I was up with the Doug and the wee man, and then when I came back, dinner was ready, and by that time it was too late to make mash.
Right, okay, right.
But the roast potatoes were good. So the roast potatoes in the air fryer. I would highly recommend putting roast potatoes in an air fryer, but don't get Aunt Bessie's roast potatoes, because Aunt Betty's roast potatoes, for me, still have that taste that they've been frozen.
Right.
There's that kind of aftertaste. They're not the best. So always go for real tatties. And what you do is you sprinkle them with that spray stuff, the oil.
Olive oil.
Yeah, that. You spray it with some of that, then you throw it in the air fryer and they crisp up. It's really nice. It would be nice to have some mash. I made the gravy when I got into the house. A wee bit of black pepper, a bit of onion. It was lovely. A wee bit of pesto. Brussels sprouts. Some Brussels sprouts. Put some wee butter with black pepper. Amazing. So I had that yesterday with the mother-in-law for Easter, and then we handed Easter eggs to one another.
Oh, like in a circle?
Right. No, we were just sat around the dining room table, and then we just shared Easter eggs. You have an Easter egg. You have an Easter egg. And I've got a boring Easter egg. I got a Kit Kat. That's quite boring.
They were on offer in the co-op.
That's maybe why I got it. But it was a very boring Easter egg, because Kit Kats aren't that great. Anyway. And then I watched a movie last night.
Great.
To celebrate the Easter weekend, and it was called The Night House.
Right, okay.
The Night House is... Oh, go and give me my movie music. Thank you. The Night House, which is classed a horror mystery.
Okay.
Normally you get like a horror or a paranormal or something, but this is a horror mystery, and it's a kind of whodunit and what was going on, and you got a big twist at the end. So,
so look out for the big twist at the end, everyone, if you watch it. So if you're expecting something to happen, fully expect it, because there will be a twist at the end.
Well, to see The Sixth Sense, everyone knows there's a twist in it. You just have to try and figure out what the twist is, and it's clear early on in the movie that there's something going on in this house. It's called Night House. It's an atmospheric horror that engages you intellectually and emotionally. So it kind of ticks so many different boxes. So you have to be quite bright and intelligent to watch it to try and figure out what's going on. And it still leaves you some questions to answer in regards to what's going on. I would highly recommend it. It was released in 2021. And we thoroughly enjoyed that. It's a great way to spend your Easter Sunday watching a horror mystery.
I know that somebody will already be typing out on the YouTube comments the timestamp for this, so that people can spool forward and miss that.
Well, they're not only going to miss the movie review, they're going to miss my chat about my dinner.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, they will.
Do you know what I had for dessert?
No, I don't.
So before we watched the movie, I made everyone a cup of tea. and we had the choice of apple strudel with cream or a lemon tart. And I went for the lemon tart, and it was very lovely. It had little bits of lemon rind in the lemony bit, so it gave you that kind of zest, very zesty. And then I had that and washed it down with a cup of tea. And then everybody went and got themselves ready for bed. Then we all got on the sofa and we watched the Night House horror mystery movie, and I had some popcorn.
Thank God I'm off next week. I need a holiday. Honestly, I need a holiday.
Do you know what? People love reality telly. This is a version of reality telly. I'm giving you an insight into my life. Yeah. People think that
a terrifying insight into the life people of
think
Hugh Cameron.
People think because I'm famous, right? Like really famous, and they see me and they like scream at me and they shout at me and they want my autograph and they want a selfie. You know what I mean? But I'm just a normal guy like everybody else.
You're so far away from normal. Right. It's not even
and
funny.
Just give me a wee insight into my house and what goes on. It's just like everybody else. I don't hang out with stars. I don't hang out with celebrities and famous people. I'm just me. I pick up dog shit like anyone else who owns a dog.
I don't even have a dog. I've told you about that before. Stop going around the streets picking up dog shit. We've been through this before.
I do my bit for the community.
Exactly. You sure that's coffee on your jumper? Right, okay. Last week's quiz. Siam the Danger says, Ewen got done like the lassie at the start of Scream with that Friday the 13th question. Needs to do his homework on horror movies.
Is that what his advice is?
Yeah, exactly. RFC fan 1996. Think he might be a Rangers fan. As soon as the question left producer Dan's mouth, I said to myself, Ewan's going to say Jason. And lo and behold, he didn't disappoint. Greatest podcast out there at the moment, just for Ewan's greeting alone. Thank you very much for that kind comment. Bobby Supper says, sorry to be that guy, but I'm afraid for the second week in a row, there's some dubiety about the quiz.
Thank you.
If you're going by the 1980 version of Friday the 13th, then yes, Jason's mum is the killer. However, in the 2009 movie of the same name, the killer is indeed Jason Voorhees.
Correct.
And as you didn't specify that it was the 1980 version, I think Ewan has to get the point.
So that's 2 weeks in a row where there's been a lot of dubiety and controversy surrounding the quiz. And the point that's just been made there was a fantastic point, because there was a remake of Friday the 13th, as the boy alluded to. And in the remake of Friday the 13th, Jason is the killer. Dan, who was producing last week, who gave me that question, didn't specify which Friday the 13th he was talking about. No point did he say the original Friday the 13th or the remake of Friday the 13th.
Would you
say that both quizzes in the last 2 weeks, bit like the 1993 Grand National, where party politics won, it was a null and void race and a null and void victory. So no points for you last week or the week before. Now, I know that Producer John's not here again this week because he's skiving. And who have we got today?
We've got Producer Scott today.
Oh, yeah, we've got Scott today. So he can't make a decision because he's just in here on work experience.
Well, I can't.
So no, you don't. You're not. Who the fuck are you?
I'm not saying I'm making a decision.
No, you're not. John makes a decision, not you. So
precisely,
as it stands right now, there's no chance. Changing the scores until John makes a decision on that next week. Oh, not even next week. He's not even here. You're not even here.
I'm not even here next week.
Well, when you get back.
So, just to clarify, even if he would have specified the original, would you have still said Jason? Or did you know it was Jason's mum?
I knew it was Jason's mum.
In the original?
I knew it was Jason's mum's original, but I genuinely only just recently watched the remake of Halloween and also Friday the 13th. Just recently. Just this year.
Just recently.
This year.
Just recently.
This year in the last 3-4 months.
Just that is recently.
Yeah.
On Ewan's Scottish Cup predictions, Porgy Boy 65. Ewan is delusional if he thinks that Hearts will meet Aberdeen in the Cup final. So far this season, the Jambos haven't shown up against Rangers. Celtic and Rangers Cup final all the way. Hearts splitting the Old Firm. Wakey, wakey. And as for that excuse of a Cockney accent, that leaves a lot to be desired. On Christian Tits. You guys are fair milking the tits patter. I get tits need support, but let's nip it in the bud. That's from 1872 Ger's True Blue. I think he might be a Rangers fan. Actually had some devastating news over the weekend about Christian Titz.
I know.
He is officially out of the running to be the Aberdeen manager.
Yeah, an Aberdeen contact source said to us that Christian Titz is way down the pecking order. He will not be the new Aberdeen manager, but at the moment...
Titz is sagging in the pecking order.
Titz is sagging in the pecking order, but the way that Aberdeen are going about their business, they may have to go back for some Titz.
Mm-hmm. Possibly, yeah.
Because nobody else wants the job.
They might have to reassess the tits.
They have to reassess it. So
we'll keep you up to date with all the tits.
We've
chat.
Done all the puns.
We have.
We've done it.
There's none left.
I can hear the wheels in your head churning as you try to come up with another pun that's not already been said.
Yeah.
Let's just stop it now.
Yeah. I did the sagging one there. That was.
That's about that it. There's nothing left.
That was a new one this week.
Is there any other pun on Christian Titz that we haven't yet covered?
I don't know. They might be.
Breastfeeding? Is there a pun on breastfeeding?
Possibly, but I mean, I think it's... I just hate to think we've been fed false information. Okay, review of the week from Fiona Rayburn says, Stephen, how do you put up with him for 80 shows? Fiona, I have absolutely no idea, but here we are.
Hold on a second. Fiona, you're here.
Yeah, I know.
Clearly loves me.
Well, I'm not sure about that.
And the reason that she was being negative is because she knows she can't have me.
Okay, remember, you can leave your comments anytime on Twitter at BigFootballScore, and you can comment on the YouTube video as you're watching it as well. We'll read out the best of them next week, or Ewen will, because I'm not here. Just search for the Big Scottish Football Podcast or head to the Super Scoreboard, Clyde Super Scoreboard channel. You can subscribe there as well.
I know why you're not here next week, because you fear that Rangers are going to beat Celtic.
No, because I'm not in the country.
Oh, you're in Atlanta.
Yeah, this time next week I'll be in Atlanta.
What, I mean, you've actually struck the jackpot with your missus.
How?
I mean, she's a great looking girl.
Mm-hmm.
She's a lovely lass.
Mm-hmm.
Great personality.
Mm-hmm. And I get to go on nice holidays.
And she's intelligent. She's bright. She's a heart surgeon.
No, she's not a surgeon.
But she's a heart specialist.
She is, yeah.
Heart specialist. And she gets to go to all these wonderful places around the world to go and see other heart people who are also heart specialists. So she goes to places like Japan and America and all that. And because Stephen is here doing what he does here, which is just talk pish for a living, he gets to go from these fancy places because his missus drags him along.
I know.
So you're very lucky, mate.
What a life. Right, do you want to talk about the football?
Yes!
Okay, right, let's start in the Premiership then, and let's start on Saturday. So, where do you want to begin, Ewen Cameron?
What was the first game at the weekend?
They were all 3 o'clock kickoffs. So, do you want to do it alphabetically?
Yeah, let's do it alphabetically.
Aberdeen 2, Ross County 1. Big win for Aberdeen. They needed that. Peter Leaven still in charge, of course, obviously. They were booed off at half-time. Ross County did have a couple of decent chances, actually. And, again, poor defending for Simon Murray's goal. But Miofsky getting the opener just about. I think they've given it to him. I think it's a bit of a shambles of a first goal. Then, obviously, Jamie McGrath, who's actually scored some really important goals this season. Jamie McGrath, he's popped up with some really important goals. So Aberdeen look like they're fine.
When
it comes to the relegation playoff, and they're not going to make it into the top six, obviously.
No.
But County are still in that relegation playoff. St Johnstone are only a point ahead, so it's all looking a wee bit tasty down the bottom there.
It was a much needed win for Aberdeen. It was a tricky game. I mean, Ross County equalise just purely for comedy value. I wanted Ross County to win because the meltdown would have been hilarious from the Aberdeen fans. But they got the win. That'll be them fine. They're not going to get dragged into any issues in regards to relegation playoff positions and that. So they'll just want to be the best of the rest in the bottom six now. That's their goal. That's their aim. And also they've got a semi-final to look forward to against Celtic.
Yes, they do. So they play Livingston away next Saturday, and then before the semi-final and the split, they're at home to Dundee. So
they're fine. They'll look minimum 4 points there.
Ross County are away to Kilmarnock next Saturday.
Tough.
And their final game before the split is at home to Rangers.
Yeah.
on the Sunday lunchtime.
I don't see them getting anything in the next two games.
Right, so let's move on to Hearts versus Kilmarnock. Hearts won, Kilmarnock won. Vargas celebrating his new five-year contract by opening the scoring on Saturday, but Kilmarnock came roaring back into it in the second half again. Just one loss in nine games now, and look, a decent bet for fourth place and a cracking goal from your favourite Marley Watkins as well.
I watched the highlights of that game, the extended highlights of it, and Hearts should have been miles ahead in that first half. We created a load of great chances. Georgie Grant, Vargas.
Shankland had a chance.
Shankland had a really good chance, and unlike him, it was straight down the throat of the goalkeeper. We could have been 2 or 3 nil up at half time, but fair play to Kilmarnock. They were the better side in the second half, created some decent chances, and then Marley Watkins picks it, an absolute beauty. And what I would say about Marley Watkins' goal from 20 plus yards is that Hearts gave him all the time in the world to look up and then wrap his right foot around
it. You can't give
it.
Marley Watkins that sort of time.
You cannot give him that kind of time.
You've been saying that for ages.
Frankie Kent, first of all, the poor defensive header from a long ball, that it was just awful. And then he doesn't engage with Marley Watkins, and then he curls in an absolute cracker. Can I just point out, what probably one of the saves of the season, the save that Xander Clark makes.
Very good save.
From, I think, again, Marley Watkins. Xander Clark's going the other way, mm-hmm. and he puts it a left hand and he scoops it away.
Really good save.
Stunning save, point blank save. So well done to Xander Clark for
that.
Here's
a question for you. Hearts are going to finish third. Are you slightly concerned that Hearts are putting their feet up?
Yes. That's my concern.
They've obviously got the semi-final coming up as well.
But in the league, my concern is, and I kind of alluded to this on Saturday on the big Saturday football show.
They've got St Mirren away and Livingston at home before the split and before the semi-final.
4 points. Because I think going to St Mirren is a really tough place to go. And they've got a huge battle on their hand in trying to get it top six.
It's hard to get back into gear once you've lost it.
Yes. No.
Because they've got none to play for really in the league. They're going to finish third.
The Hearts have done what they set out to do, was to finish third in the league after the disappointment of last year, and they've done that. But Stephen Naismith and others did say at the start of the campaign that the other goal for this season was to close the gap on the top two. Now, as it stands right now, where we are, we're
17 points behind Rangers.
Yeah. How many points behind Celtic?
18 points.
Oh, there's only a point now between those two. Again, that's closer than we were last year.
11 points in front of Kilmarnock.
Yeah. So, I mean, third's done. So if we can maintain progress in that regard, closing down the big two and improving on what happened last year and the year before, then we'll be happy with that. My concern is that the feet do go up. And if we get knocked to the Scottish Cup and then the remaining games in the split are meaningless, really, because we've got third in the bag. So, yeah, I think we've got a great chance against Rangers. That's our cup final. Because if we win that, we win the Scottish Cup.
You think you beat Celtic or Aberdeen in the final?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that Hearts cup final is against Rangers. We win that, we win the Scottish Cup. It's that big a game. I think we're good enough to beat Celtic and also Aberdeen. And I think that Hearts are due Rangers. We're due to put in a good performance against Rangers, but we'll get to that near the time, but I think we've got a good chance.
Motherwell won, St Mirren won on Saturday. The opening goal, I thought, was hilarious from Marcus Fraser. It just sort of bounced off his head and went in, because he obviously couldn't see it properly because of the sun. And he managed to guide it in, so 1-0 to St Mirren, and then obviously Theo Bear scoring again. He scored 10 goals in his last 14 games.
And St Johnstone are struggling to score goals, and they let him go in the summer.
They did. So Motherwell, obviously, are fine as well. They're not going to get dragged into stuff at the bottom, you wouldn't imagine.
I think Motherwell are really unlucky this season.
They've got Dundee and Hibs before the split.
Yeah, I think Motherwell are a really good side.
St Mirren have Hearts and Celtic, which will be difficult.
Yeah, I think that they have been very good this season. They've just been really unlucky. Every time I've watched them play, they're in the game. They're creating chances. And yeah, I think they should be in a better position, to be honest. Because I think they're a good side. And I do like Stuart Kettlewell as well. So they deserve their draw.
They can still arithmetically make it into the top six.
No, John, you mean arithmetically?
Yeah. And Motherwell play Dundee this Saturday, who are obviously in sixth place. So if Motherwell beat Dundee,
where's that?
It's at Dens Park.
Is it Dens?
So if Motherwell beat Dundee, say Hibs somehow managed to lose against St Johnstone, then Motherwell would go into the final game before the split, taking on Hibs, and Dundee are away at Aberdeen. So it's not completely out with the realms of possibility, because obviously Dundee still have Rangers to play as well. But if Dundee, if Motherwell beat Dundee on Saturday,
huge,
then it keeps it all in the mix for the final game before the split. Now, the chances of happening are all.
It'd be good if it was to happen that way, because it'd be exciting.
I fancy Hibs to take something for St Johnstone. Like, if you know, if Hibs draw...
Where are Hibs playing St Johnstone?
At Easter Road.
Oh, they'll beat them.
And then it's... But if they somehow draw... Then it all goes down at the final
last game.
So, assuming they beat Dundee, of course. So, big weekend for Motherwell and St Mirren. As I said, a couple of tough fixtures before they go into the split. They'll be delighted that they're still in the hunt from fourth place. Only 2 points behind Kilmarnock. Elsewhere on Saturday, let's get to Ibrox then. And it was Rangers 3, Hibs 1. So, Rangers' owning of Hibs this season continues. We'll talk about the penalty and stuff in just a wee second and VAR WTF. But in terms of the performance, obviously a cracking goal from James Tavernier. Great strike. The highest scoring defender in
UK history.
UK history. And I think it was 450th game for Rangers as well or something like that.
And Ronald Koeman is the highest scoring defender in the world.
Uh-huh.
How many goals has he got?
I have no idea.
I know that's the stat, that he is the highest scoring in the world when it comes to defenders. So Tavernier's got UK.
So obviously Rangers score after all the penalty stuff a couple of minutes after that. They do actually take the lead through Tavernier.
Munkgun?
Eh? What?
Say that again, Scott. 192 for Koeman.
192 for Koeman.
What's Tavernier got? Is it 136? 37?
I've got no idea.
Go and look that up for me, Scott. I'm pretty sure it's like 136 goals. He's not that... I don't... He's not going to catch Koeman, is he? How old is he, Tavernier?
33, something like that.
No idea. What I was going to say about... he's got 131 goals.
I was just going to say that I thought Rangers' second goal was a cracker. Great ball in for Cantwell on the right-hand side.
Oh, and Desser's
Pivers at home. And also, Rabi Matondo, great goal as well. I mean, poor defending from Hibs.
What was interesting about that game is that Nick Montgomery, very honest in his post-match assessment, saying it's the best team he's played all season in Rangers at Ibrox. And I actually thought Hibs had a wee chance, because I think Hibs are a really good side. Malouda, one of my favourite players of the last 3 or 4 months, has been outstanding for Hibs and scored a really good goal. Started to move in the halfway line, gets Hibs back to 1-1. But Rangers had 30 shots on goal. They seem to be hitting a lot of shots on goal. They've done it to Hearts, they've done it to Aberdeen, they've done it to Hibs as well. They're good going forward, but I still think, and I know Rangers fans are not going to appreciate me saying this, but I think Goldson and Suter are a bit of a bomb scare at times. You can get at them. And they've just been lucky that Hibs and your Hearts and your Aberdeens of this world and your Kilmarnocks just don't have the quality to punish them. Celtic do have the quality to punish them. So it'll be interesting to see what happens at the weekend when the Old Firm game comes around. But Rangers thoroughly deserved the win. I thought they were excellent on the day. 3-1 going on 6-1.
Yeah. Malida, do you think he'll be at Hibs next season?
Oh, what a player he is.
I mean, they need to hope that they've got some sort of like clause, because he looks very, very good, because there'll be other teams sniffing about him, I would imagine.
He's on loan from Hertha Berlin, and he made a cameo appearance in the Celtic game when Hibs lost by 2 goals to win the 2 Adam Ida penalties. And I said at the time in that game, oh, he looks a player. And then since then, Steve Cowan, who we work with in the Big Saturday Football Show, every time he sees Hibs, he raves about Malouda. Every time I see the boy, I'm raving about him. I think he's an outstanding footballer. Holds the ball up well, runs, skillful, can score goals, on loan from Hertha Berlin. I'm not sure what the situation is with Hibs, but he's definitely putting himself in a shot window. And if Shankland was to go, I would love Hearts to sign him.
So, Hibs, they are out of the top six at the moment after they lost on Saturday to Rangers and obviously...
I still make Hibs favourites to get in the top six.
Dundee jump up after beating St Johnstone, which we'll get to in just a wee second. As I mentioned, Hibs play St Johnstone at home this Saturday. A win there would be huge, but Dundee obviously play Motherwell, so it's still in their hands. And then you've obviously got Dundee versus Rangers next midweek, and then Hibs finish away at Motherwell. So it's still all up in the air whether Hibs are getting into this top six or not.
Who do you say are favourites? Who would you put your money on now? Now, Dundee are there right now because they win at the weekend.
I think Dundee beat Motherwell on Saturday. I think Hibs beat St Johnson. I don't think Dundee get anything from Rangers. And it all comes down to the final game. And I think Hibs beat Motherwell. Dundee don't beat Aberdeen. So I think Hibs getting into the top six.
So it will go down to the last day?
Aye. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Aye, I agree. I think it goes down to the last day. And I think Hibs' firepower makes them slight favourites to finish in the top six. And I hope they do finish in the top six because I want the Edinburgh Derby.
Okay, right. So it was St Johnstone 1, Dundee 2. Again, a couple of talking points in terms of VAR, WTF. We'll get to that in a second. But a great two really brilliant goals to open the score. And the first one from Lyle Cameron from about 45 yards.
Great goal.
Obviously, great finish from there.
He's linked with Hearts, by the way. Just want to put that out there. Hearts are being linked with that boy.
Sidibe with an overhead kick as well. So it was a great finish, but obviously Craig Levein and St Johnstone are mega, mega struggling.
He did say that's the best they've played since he's been there, and they still lost the game. And I thought they were unlucky. They created so many chances. Unlike St Johnstone, they actually created chances, and they could have won that game quite easily. But fair play to Dundee.
Yeah.
Even your manager, Tony Dock, says we were lucky to come away with 3 points there.
Yeah, so St Johnstone, as I mentioned, away at Hibs before the split, and they finish at home to Kilmarnock. So they'll just be looking to try and get as many points on the board away from Ross County as they can. And then finally yesterday, it was Celtic 3, Livingston 0, or Livingston 0, Celtic 3, I should say. So Celtic back to the top spot, eventually overpowering Livingston in the second half.
It was always going to happen.
Yeah, of course. So, you know, Jamie Brandon with the own goal, Bernardo, and then Matt O'Reilly. So Celtic going into the big game on Sunday.
They were good yesterday. I thought Hatate.
Hatate made a big difference.
Huge.
I thought, yeah.
And do you know what he does? Unlike most Celtic players in that midfield, he always looks forward. And that's not me having a pop at McGregor because he's one of my favourite players. But Hatate, his energy, his pace, his intelligence, he doesn't really waste a pass. He's always a threat. He's there on the edge of the box. He makes such a huge difference. And what a time to get him back ahead of the Old Firm game. Now, I thought it was a bit of a risk playing him yesterday on that pishy carpet at Livingston, but he breezed the game. He was very good. And the rumours are that McGregor could be back as well. So what a pick-me-up that is for Celtic if they have Hatate McGregor in that midfield for the game at Ibrox.
Who's favourite?
Rangers, because they're at Ibrox. I have to make Rangers favourite because they have been very good. They do create a number of chances. I do think they're susceptible at the back, and that's why I think we're in for an absolute beauty at the weekend.
I don't think Celtic are very good defensively either, to be honest with you.
Well, Carter Vickers makes them better.
Carter Vickers does, but
he does make them
obviously
better.
Obviously Hart, and then if you've got Scales or, you know.
Yeah, I think we are in for an absolute cracker. Now, I know there's a lot of people on Twitter and on Facebook who are suggesting that the winner of the Old Firm game on Saturday wins the league. I don't buy that.
So if Celtic win, they would go
Four clear,
but Rangers would have a game in hand against Dundee. Rangers win, then they'll go 2 points clear with a game in hand. I mean,
well, no, if Rangers win and they go two clear, they'll beat Dundee. That'll be five clear going into the split.
Well, I mean, I think that's quite...
Well, it's not because the reason... This is why I disagree with so many fans.
If Rangers win on Sunday, they are such heavy favourites.
Oh, no, I agree.
And Celtic need snookers then. They need other teams to do them favours.
Because I think this goes to the wire. I genuinely think this goes to the wire. Even if Rangers win at the weekend, I'll tell you why. If Rangers win at the weekend and they beat Dundee midweek and they go five clear, when it gets to split and you play those five games, they've still got to go to Parkhead. Mm-hmm. They lose that. It's only 2 points, isn't it?
But they still need to slip up somewhere else, and Celtic need to be... no slip ups from
but
them.
But Rangers have got three away games to Celtic's two away games. And they've got... Rangers have got to go to Hearts. Rangers, I think, have got to go to Hibs, if Hibs are in the top six. And the Rangers not have to go to St Mirren as well. They're not easy games. So that's what I'm saying. Even if Rangers win, as much as they'll be massive favourites... and momentum may carry them over the line, I don't think it's done. And a lot of Rangers fans seem to think it is done if they win at the weekend because they're assuming that they're going to go to Dens and win to go five clear. Now, I think they would probably go to Dens and win.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a huge game at the weekend, but nothing is done if Rangers win. because the game at Parkhead is huge and Rangers got three away games in the split.
I think if Rangers win on Sunday, that's it. Because I can't,
really?
I can't see Rangers slipping up other than the game at Parkhead.
What was the season? Somebody on YouTube and Twitter and that will tell me. I'm pretty sure it was when I was on the Real Radio Football phone in. When I was on the Real Radio Football phone now,
the Real Football phone in with Ewen Cameron and Alan Ruff. Call now on 0845 100
2101. Meet.
You might know this, Stephen, because you're pretty good at this when it comes to remembering
well,
shit.
Can you sort of furnish me with a question, please?
Going into the last five games of the season, were Celtic not something like five or six clear and Rangers caught them to win it? Was that a helicopter Sunday?
I have no idea.
But there was. I remember being on the football phone.
I mean, I'm not saying that. No, but it can happen.
No, I remember being on the football phone. Wait. Can I just finish what I'm saying? Because you've said you think it's done if Rangers win at the weekend.
Yeah, but I was going to tell you why. Because I think Rangers don't look like they're going to drop any points against anyone else apart from Celtic. So,
but the Celtic's got your Tynecastle.
Yeah, and they'll win.
Oh, Stephen.
You're so dismissive at Hearts.
Well, I mean, you're really dismissive. What did we just do? Celtic a couple of weeks ago. We played them off the pitch.
Right. Okay.
Right. And we're due one against Rangers. We're due one against Rangers.
That's not how it works.
Well, we're due one because we've not been great against them in recent
Rangers
times.
Rangers have won 10 out of 11 games since they lost to Celtic.
Right. But can I make my point?
Yes.
I'm pretty sure it was Helicopter Sunday, if memory serves me right. I'm sure somebody will correct me somewhere. When Rangers came back from being five behind going into the split and they won the league on the final day of the season when Motherwell beat Celtic and Rangers beat Hibs at Easter Road. So that's my point. That's why I think it goes to the wire. Because even if Rangers do go five clear by winning at the weekend and then winning against Dundee, I still think the league is up for grabs because the game at Parkhead will determine who wins the league. If Rangers were to go there and get a draw, if they're five clear, done. But if they go there and lose and it's down to 2 points, because I think what they'll do with that Celtic-Rangers game, that'll be played early doors. They won't keep that to the third or fourth game. I think you're going to get that as possibly the second game in the split. And then it's all to play for if Celtic were to win that. Look, you're right. Rangers will be massive favourites if they win at the weekend to go in and win the league. But I wouldn't, like a lot of Rangers fans, be confident. Because it's already been proved in the past, Helicopter Sunday proved that anything can happen.
No, of course, anything can happen. But I mean...
Yeah, and Hearts can beat Rangers at Tynecastle. Hearts can beat Rangers at Hampden.
It's also, I think, the reason I think that if Rangers win on Sunday and then they beat Dundee, it's over, is because then Celtic can't afford to slip up as well. You know, Celtic can't afford... And they need to beat Rangers at Parkhead. They can't afford any more slip-ups. And I think there's maybe a slip up in Celtic, but as well as there might be a slip up in Rangers.
Right.
And there's so five points difference.
Let's assume that it's Hibs in the top six. Celtic's three home games, because they've got three home games to the two away games.
Uh-huh.
Their home games are Rangers, Hearts, and Hibs. They'd be favourites to win those games.
Of course they would.
Of course they would, right? Because they're at home. Parkhead's a bit of a fortress and all that, right? They're two away games. You wouldn't expect them to drop any points in those games.
Away to Kilmarnock?
No. I think they'd be good enough to go there and win it for a title. I think they go there. Kilmarnock have already had their season.
Listen.
They'll have finished fourth. They're in European football. Their heads are elsewhere. They're thinking of the sunbeds and fighting off tourists to get a sunbed round the pool and all that kind of stuff.
I know, but
then Amber Soler will be out and everything. Where Celtic and Rangers got so much to play for.
But Hearts will be really, really trying because they won't be thinking about the
We've got a cup final to look forward to.
Right, okay.
That's what it is. Right. We've got to keep ourselves in tip-top shape for a cup final.
Okay, great.
That's what's happening.
Okay, thought that might be the case.
So what I'm saying is I think we're in for a fantastic end to the season.
Yes, I think it'll be tight on Sunday as well. Mm-hmm. I don't think there'll be much in it.
Nope.
It wouldn't surprise me if it ends a draw.
I think if I was a betting man, I would go... It's more likely to be a draw or a Rangers win. I can't see Celtic winning at Ibrox. I think Clement was a very angry man after the performance at Parkhead in that 2-1 defeat, and Celtic again were the better side. the first game of the season, Celtic were the better side, deserved their victory. I think Clement is an angry manager. I think that he will be well up for it. The players will be up for it as well. They've got a full week to prepare for it. They'll have 50-odd thousand fans behind them as well. I think that if Celtic come out of there with a draw, they'll be over the moon with that because they've got Rangers at Parkhead.
It keeps it in their own hands.
It keeps it in their own hands.
So I think...
I don't see Celtic winning, no.
I think it'll be tight. I think it'll be very tight. I couldn't call it. So Celtic 3-0 winners yesterday against Livingston. By the way, I should mention the funniest part of the weekend, which is, of course, the Hibs player hitting the ball off Joe Newell.
And then it hit the other, it hit Cadden as well.
Yeah, aye. So it's had more than 3 million views.
Only Scottish football could provide such entertainment.
Right, in the Championship, probably the game of the weekend in Scotland was Dundee United against Raith Rovers, and Dundee United finally got their act together. They're now 4 points clear at the top of the table. Raith Rovers do have a game in hand, but more than 10,000 at Tannadice on Saturday. Dundee United thoroughly deserved their victory, and is that it in terms of the title in the Championship?
I've been saying it for weeks and months that Dundee United will win promotion and they'll get there comfortably. They've made hard work of it. I thought Dundee United thoroughly deserved their win at Tannadice. It was 2-0 going on 3-4-5-0.
Great goal by Tony Watt as well.
Great goal. Brilliant finish. And that settled their nerves. It settled the Dundee United fans' nerves at such an early goal.
Wraith hit the top of the bar, yeah. Zach Rudden, but apart from that, that was it.
Like, and their goalkeeper keeps them in it at 1-0, and then they get the second goal, Dundee United, and then it's easy street for them. Listen, I'm one of those fans that looks at the bigger picture and what's best for Scottish football. And I've always wanted Dundee United to win promotion for one reason only. Get them in the Premiership, great football club, great fan base, we get the Dundee Derby. Keep Raith where they are, because you've got Falkirk who are coming up, you've got Dunfermline who are also in the Championship. What a league that turns into as well, with Partick Thistle in there, Raith Rovers, Falkirk, Dunfermline, brilliant. They're going to get huge attendances, the average of the attendances will go up as well. And then the following season after that, if you can get a Dunfermline or a Falkirk replacing Ross County in the Premier League, what a league we've got. Then the season after that, you maybe get Dunfermline to come up as well. So you got Dunfermline, Falkirk, Dundee, Dundee United, Hibs,
Falkirk
and Hearts.
Are getting back-to-back promotions, are they?
Well, I don't care who it is, but in the next 2 years, I want to
I
see
care.
That. I want in the next.
I would care.
For what's good for Scottish football, I want to see Dundee United, Dunfermline, and Falkirk in the Premier League.
Doesn't happen very often, unfortunately. Right, so Dundee United, as I mentioned, 4 points clear at the top. Raith Rovers. I think from their point of view, they just need to hope their season doesn't peter out now, because they've still got the playoffs to play for. They're going to finish second, and they'll fancy their chances playoffs.
That'll hurt what happened to them at the weekend.
So they've obviously got a game in hand. It's at Airdrie at home, I think. Tough game. Airdrie, who lost on Friday night to Scott Brown's Air United.
They deserved their win as well, Air United.
So Raith Rovers are at home to Air United on Saturday, so tough game there. Then they play Airdrie at home next Tuesday, and then they've got Partick Thistle at home again, and then it is away to Inverness, who are scrapping for their lives before a couple of games towards the end of the season. Morton away, and then they're at home to probably already relegated Arbroath by that time as well. So do you think for Raith Rovers, it's not in their hands anymore?
No.
Because that's them done with Dundee United. Dundee United are capable of slipping up, quite clearly.
I think they have had their blip, and that was a huge win for them, and they can see the finishing line in sight.
They play, like, so Dundee United's running is not easy.
See when you turn the corner?
Uh-huh.
In the Epsom Derby, what's that corner called? Tattenham Corner.
Right, okay.
You get around Tattenham Corner and you're lining up the final straight, and you're heading down the straight in the Epsom Derby, and you've got the rail to support you as well, and you're a length ahead of your rivals. That's where Dundee United are right now. The line is there, and yes, Raith Rovers' nose is at the backside of Dundee United. Because but slowly but surely Dundee United are going to gallop away from the nose off Raith Rovers.
Great.
And then they're going to get to the final Furlong. So, and then they're just going to stretch that lead a wee bit further, and then they're going to hit the line 3 or 4 lengths clear of the rival, meaning 3 or 4 points.
Right.
And they'll win the league quite comfortably in the end. So I don't see Dundee United making the mistake they've been making in recent weeks when they lost to your lot, etc.
So Dundee United to win the league, Raith Rovers will finish second. Partick Thistle look like they're going to finish third as well, which means between Dunfermline, Morton, Airdrie and Ayr United, there is one playoff spot up for grabs. At the moment, Dunfermline are in fourth place after a 3-2 win against Arbroath. Brilliant first half, 3-0 up at half time, absolutely cruising. Shocking second half. James McPake was livid with the second half performance. Arbroath got themselves back into a couple of set pieces. Dunfermline managed to hold on, get the 3 points, and 3 wins on the spin for Dunfermline. Dunfermline play Partick Thistle at East End Park this Saturday, which is going to be a big one.
Do you know what it is with Dunfermline? It's like watching them in the Grand National. They were coasting it down the far side, and there's 6 jumps in the far side at the start of the Grand National, and you were easy. You're flying over the first 5 jumps, and then you get to Beecher's Brook. And Beecher's Brook is our both scoring 2 goals. You stumble at Beecher's Brook when you jump the fence because at the other side there's a dip and you got down on your front legs, but you pop back up again. But before you know it, our both are up your backside and they've scored 2 goals. But well done, you've held on for the victory when you jump the chair and then you get round to the elbow.
Right, I can't take any more horse racing analogies, I'm afraid. Morton beat Queen's Park 2-0 on Saturday. Partick Thistle beating Inverness, even though, you know, Duncan Ferguson was, he was pretty pleased with his team's performance. So
That was like them running in the Kentucky
No, dump. It wasn't. Who's going to finish in fourth place? Dunfermline, Morton, Airdrie or Ayr United?
Well,
Dunfermline 3 wins in a row. Morton, first win in a long time on Saturday. Airdrie obviously losing on Friday night. Ayr United are win-loss.
Do you know what it comes down to? You've got Dundee United at the top, you've got Raith Rovers in second, and you've got Partick Thistle in third.
Uh-huh.
Those 3 horses are ahead of you, right?
Speaking about horses.
In behind those 3 horses are the 3 you've just mentioned, but we're on a dirt track.
Who's going to finish in fourth place?
The sand from the front 3 are kicking up in your face and you're blinded by the sand. And it's whoever's got the clearest view to get through will get the playoff position.
Right, I can't handle this, I'm afraid. So Arbroath 4 losses in a row. They are heading for League One, and Inverness beginning to look a wee bit cut adrift. They're 4 points behind Queen's Park and they're running out of matches. Right, let's get down into League One. And Falkirk have won the league.
Oh, they've coasted it.
Don't bother. They're unbeaten this season. They beat Montrose 7-1. If you come out with another fucking horse here, I'm going to go mental.
It's like Shergar. Nobody was catching Shergar.
Montrose 1, Falkirk 7. Producer John was sending us videos of celebration and all the rest
and
of it as well,
and
pubs, and I'm like, you know, it's all a bit unseemly, sort of, you know, celebrating such a minor victory after taking
in a part-time league
after taking 5 years to get out of it as well. But they will be playing Championship football next season as well. So Hamilton, they slipped up on Saturday against Queen of the South, 0-0 it finished there. It was 1-1 between Alloa and Annan. Cove Rangers 4, Stirling Albion 2, and Kelty Hearts getting a win, which will probably secure their League One status. 3-1 against Edinburgh City. They're now 6 points clear of the relegation playoff spot.
That's all that Kelty wanted, was just to
absolutely.
What's the word I'm looking for? They wanted to cement themselves.
Consolidate their place.
That's a word. I'm going to have to use that word more often in my analogies and in my descriptions of things in life.
Right.
Consolidate. Like, you consolidate your marriage.
No.
Well, you do sometimes. Could you consolidate your marriage?
Consolidate your marriage.
Go and just Google.
Do you mean consummate your marriage?
No. But when you
consolidate your marriage. No, you can consolidate all your monthly payments into one easy, simple monthly loan. If you watch a lot of daytime television, you can't consolidate all your marriages into one simple monthly marriage.
All right, go and just do your Google thing and just see what how they describe it in English dictionary for consolidate. I think you can consolidate a marriage.
You can consolidate. You're thinking of consummate a marriage.
No, it's not consummate. I know what consummate is. Consummate is when my wife carried me over the threshold.
Right, good.
And threw me on the bed. A story for another day. But see, the consolidate thing, go and just Google it.
What am I Googling?
The words, and read what it says it means, because I think you can consolidate a marriage.
You can't consolidate a marriage.
Read out what it says.
Make something physically stronger or more solid.
Yeah, because it...
Combine into a single, more effective or coherent whole.
That first bit, though, if you're going through a rocky time in your marriage, let's consolidate it, let's get back to basics. No?
No. Right, let's move on to League Two and hand over to the man with his finger on the button. It's President Joe Biden.
Jesus Christ, Gary Naismith, do not want to win this league. Those bastards Falkirk have now got the booking on the open top bus ahead of the mighty Warriors as they drew against Dumbarton. We'll just need to wait to do it against Dick. And by the way, that isn't a given, as East Fife are flying and could push to the playoffs. They went 8 without defeat with a win against Elgin. There was, however, a very good win for Spartans at home to Forfar, which was the Loons' first loss in 12. Stranraer and the Rose, who are under new management after Callum Elliott joined from Cowden Beef. 3-1-1, and Jobby McCall's men got pumped off the fish lover's petter head for one, leaving them like my presidential situation. In trouble, anyway, Ewan and Steven, see you on the flip side, where hopefully I will be wearing my Stinny Winners t-shirt. Ciao for now.
Ciao for now, President Joe Biden. There he is there. Okay.
Do you think he's in trouble for this year's election?
Yes.
Do you think Trump wins it?
Don't know. Couldn't call
But
it.
Does Trump get to
I think probably not. I think Biden will probably win.
But does Trump get to be
the nominee? Yes, he will. Yeah.
No, but if the court cases go against him.
Don't think it matters.
It'll
be a nominee from the deal.
And if he does become the nominee and he wins the election.
Well, he is the nominee.
Well, he isn't. You're right. He is the nominee, sorry. But if he does become president of the United States, can he pardon himself?
Yeah.
So he could get into the White House and go, right, see all these charges. I pardon myself.
Yep.
I am president. Oh, yeah.
Yep, anyway, right. VAR WTF. Let's talk refereeing decisions, please. La gente está muy loca. What the fuck? Okie dokie. Right. Lots to get through. So, Aberdeen Ross County, Kevin Clancy. It was the county goalkeeper Wickens' challenge on Duke outside the box. Only got a yellow. VAR didn't actually look at it.
Nah.
Nope.
Nah, it's fine.
I saw one yesterday, St Johnston 1, Dundee 2, so Ian Sneddon, foul on the goalkeeper from Ryan McGowan.
It's not a foul.
I thought it was a foul. I think he shoves.
Not a foul.
I think he shoves the defender into
shove.
The goalkeeper.
That's not a shove.
I think.
That's
I think
a hand a on the back. Stephen, if my hand is on your back in the street, you're not falling over. It's just your hand. It's just a hand on the back. He didn't push. It's one hand.
He shoves the defender. He shoves the defender into the keeper.
What's your interpretation of a shove?
Well, when you push somebody like that, that's a shove.
He didn't do that. He didn't actually go like that.
It's a foul.
It's not. It's a goal. I think St Johnston are really unlucky there.
However, the Dundee goalkeeper should have been sent off earlier on in the match. He caught Sidibe.
Oh, aye.
The way through.
Yeah, yeah.
And he caught him with his knee. He caught the ball and he deliberately left his knee
up there.
They didn't even look at that.
Yeah, I thought it was a red card.
I thought Dundee were very, very lucky to keep their goalkeeper on the pitch. Motherwell, St Mirren, Matthew McDermott. Should St Mirren have had a penalty against Theo Bear's handball in the box?
Yes.
Again, explain to me, Ewan.
Right, okay.
Explain to me, Ewan, the handball rule, because they just make it up on a week-to-week basis,
okay,
as far as I can see.
I am the IFAB expert when it comes to the handball rule. And 9 times out of 10, I will get it right. Let me just take back what I said. Yes, it's a penalty. You can also argue why it's not a penalty. It's point-blank range. I mean, pretty point-blank.
And there's been lots of point-blank range penalties given this season.
There has been, but there's also been some that have not been given.
Yep.
Right? So, again, it comes down to human interpretation at the end of the day. And that's where the problem is. Some referees give it, some don't. Some VAR officials will call it out and have the referee look at it again, some don't. There's no conspiracy, there's no issues or problems, or the referees are just pish. I saw some amazing penalties that were given at the weekend in the English Premiership. They should never have been a penalty. And they're, I mean, some of the decisions down south are just as bad, if not worse, than what happens here in Scotland.
Yeah, but we're not talking about that. We're talking about Scotland.
Again, I just want to clarify, this just isn't a Scotland problem. This is a problem all over Europe.
Yeah, it's a problem because VAR is absolutely shite.
Right. Do you think it's... Would you give a penalty to St Mirren there?
No.
The only reason I said yes is because they've been given more often than not this season.
But I'm
talking from a consistency point of view. Because
there's been given, zero consistency.
No, but because it's been given more often than not, that's why I would give it. But I don't think it is a penalty. Does that make sense?
I know what you're trying to say, but I mean, it's like the handball rule is a shambles.
Oh, it's a shambles.
An utter shambles.
Are we getting to this stage where every handball should be a penalty?
That would clear it up. Yeah. Don't see why not.
But then you'd have, like...
I know you're going to say, oh, but then you would have players deliberately
aiming,
hitting the ball.
Aiming the hand. Aiming to the hand.
Because that used to be the rule. And that didn't happen.
Okay.
So
listen, I think no... But yes, because it's given more often than not.
Right, Kyogo goes down in the box again.
Penalty.
Penalty for you?
100% penalty. There's contact on his right foot. The only issue I've got with Kyogo in that situation...
Kyogo.
The only issue I've got with that situation, he limped around as if he'd been poleaxed. And then 5 seconds after he was limping, and then Celtic went back possession, and he's sprinting about.
I thought...
But it was a penalty.
I thought it was a penalty as well.
It's a penalty.
But Kyogo doesn't help himself. He goes down very easily.
And he's theatrical when he goes down as well. He's rolling around and holding his foot.
I think that's probably the reason why he's not got the penalty.
So do you think his reputation goes before him?
Yeah.
And that goes against him. But again, that shouldn't be the case.
Of course. But he got caught.
Yeah. What I would say, right, see Don Robertson, and this is where VAR have to do their job. When you watch it, it's difficult for him to see if that's a penalty or not. He can't see it. Yeah. So if he can't see it, you can't give it, which is why VAR is there. Now, why Alan Muir hasn't said to Don Robertson, you might want to have to look at it because that's an error. That's a possible, what's the phrase that they say?
A clear and obvious error.
Because he doesn't see there's a crowd of players that gets rattled across by Johnson on his right foot and there's definite contact. He takes his leg away. It's a penalty for me. So Don Robertson gets a pass for me because he doesn't see it. Alan Muir, though, in the VAR booth, what are you doing, mate? Mm-hmm. There's an angle to the, just in front of the, where is it? To the left of the goal, looking right at it. He kicks his foot. And if that happens to Shankland, I'm screaming for a penalty. If the Rangers fans are watching that happens to Dessers at the weekend there against Celtic, they're screaming for a penalty. It's a penalty. It's a penalty.
Let's move on to Rangers then. So it was David Dickinson. The penalty for the challenge on Suter. We watched it.
Yeah.
Like, on the highlights.
Yeah.
Like, we saw it on social media.
Yeah.
And I was like, I can't believe they've given a penalty for that.
I'm going to say something here, and I hope people understand what I'm getting at.
Now, obviously, it didn't matter then, because...
No, it doesn't matter.
The goal got chopped off.
But we'll get to that as well. What I'm going to say about that, and people are going to think, it doesn't matter where that is on the pitch. If that is outside the box, that sort of challenge will be punished with a free kick. I think we'll agree on that. 9 times out of 10, you will see a challenge like that where you've jumped and your arm is in the air and you struck the player and the player goes down and he's holding his face. The referee will stop play and he'll give a free kick to the opposition. That happens 9 times out of 10. I watched a few of it yesterday as well in the Liverpool game, etc., etc. I think when it comes to the penalty box, the threshold is higher because a penalty is such a huge consequence of that action. I think the Hibs defender, he's only got his eyes on the ball. His arms have to go somewhere and he's jumping for it legitimately, honestly. Suter doesn't really jump for the ball. He's kind of like on his feet.
He kind of runs into him.
Runs into him a wee bit. Would it be a free kick in the centre circle? Yes. But is that a penalty? Because I think the threshold needs to be higher to give
a
penalty.
For you, it's not a penalty.
For me, it's not a penalty. I think the defender's really unlucky. I don't think it's a penalty. His eyes are on the ball. He's fixated on the ball. He's got no idea who's around him. Listen, I know that there's fans out there who are going, oh, it's a 100% penalty, blah, 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 blah. I'm just of the opinion, I think the threshold to give a penalty have to be a wee bit higher than anywhere else on the pitch. And I know that sounds like as if I'm contradicting myself, but I hope that makes sense.
Scott Wright, obviously, the follow-up was ruled out because he'd encroached into the box and, you know...
His big toe.
His toe was in the box.
Right, so yeah. But here's the thing. And the rules of the game, and this is where our... It's just my phone.
Right.
It's my ring doorbell.
Right.
Hold on. My wife's taking the dog out.
Right. Okay.
Where was I?
Does she pick up shite when she's out and about as well, or is
yeah, because we're good. We're good human
but
beings.
But just your dog shite, or no? Is just, she like you and you pick up other dogs?
No,
as
she
well?
Just does her own dog.
You come back with about like don't like loads two, of bags, two bin bags for the
yeah. What were we talking about?
We were talking about Scott Wright and the encroachment.
Yes. Okay. So I'm going to explain the rules to you. That right. Penalty should have been retaken.
Okay.
The current IFAB rules, the current rules as it stands right now, because Hibs players encroached at the same time as Scott Wright. And what the rules are at the moment is that Scott Wright reacts to the Hibs players reacting. So because the Hibs players are also encroached, the Rangers players encroach, it should be a retaken penalty.
Okay.
So the referees in Scotland don't know their own rules. But that will change in the summer when IFAB change the rules. Because if you encroach and you gain an advantage from that, i.e. which Rangers did with Scott Wright scoring because he encroached and he scored the goal, it will be an indirect free kick to the defensive team, to the opposition.
Okay, so the referee's got that wrong?
Got that wrong. It should have been retaken as a penalty to Rangers. I'm glad it didn't get retaken and I'm glad that Rangers did get the goal chopped off because I didn't think it was a penalty in the first place.
Okay. And, I think justice was done.
And I would also like to point out to the Celtic fans who are screaming about conspiracies on Twitter after that penalty was given, if there was such a massive conspiracy, the Scott Wright goal would have stood. They wouldn't have found a millimetre to find him encroaching, right? If they want Rangers to win and they want to give Rangers goals and they want to give Rangers penalties, then that goal would have stood. Because if they'd known the rules, they'd have got the penalty retaken as well, but they don't. There's no conspiracy. And I also know, looking at the stats, that Celtic have had the same amount of penalties awarded to them as Rangers this season. Shut up with the conspiracies.
Okay. That is VAR WTF. Thank you very much. This is the Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron. Let's move on. And it is our version of Scottish football's Football Room 101.
Oh, yes.
So we decided last week that the bin is back and it needs filled up again. So last week we suggested football team taglines.
We've got new music for this.
I don't think so. I don't think we have music.
Get ready to open the Big Scottish Football Trash Can.
Oh!
It's in the bin.
Oh, that's good.
That's good. Who made
I've
that?
I've not heard that before.
That's new.
That is new.
Well done, producer John. You
well
got
done,
that made.
Producer John and producer Scott for playing that as well. Aye. Well done. Right, so yes, we're going to put something in the bin. So it was football team taglines, i.e. hashtag everything from everyone, hashtag we never stop, hashtag as one,
believe.
Hashtag believe together, hashtag
believe
forward and beyond, and hashtag hearts have a new one, doing it for the badge, of course. So, right, Mark has suggested one for this show, actually, a hashtag for this show.
Oh, go on.
And the show hashtag should be a pair of bollocks.
I've been called worse.
Yeah.
It would have been better if you'd said a pair of tits.
Yeah, well, actually,
a pair of Christian tits.
Kevin has a hashtag for you, and it should be hashtag shut your face. And for Stephen, hashtag hurry up. It's a bit harsh. Right, we had over 600 votes cast in
this.
Go on. And could I have a drum roll, please, producer Scott? If we could have a drum roll. There we go. They're going in the bin. Yay! With 60% of the vote. 60% of you saying, get these rubbish hashtags in the bin. They're marketing nonsense.
Well done.
You
well
and Cameron, done. You need to nominate something for going in the bin for next week.
I know that I'm going to get close to 100% agreement on this one.
Okay.
Footballers doing TikTok videos.
Okay. I mean,
all football. Any footballer does a TikTok video, huge, get in the bin.
Huge, huge agreement from me. Rubbish.
Right across the board. They're all over the place, down south in Europe, in Scotland. TikTok videos from footballers doing their wee silly dances, etc. Have to go in the bin.
Okay. Well, fairly simple.
Can you imagine back in the day, Graeme Souness doing stuff like that?
Well, TikTok didn't exist in the 90s.
Can you imagine, let's imagine that TikTok was in the 80s and the 90s. Can you imagine Dougleish doing that?
Yeah.
No, you couldn't.
Yeah, I think
you
so.
Can't. Graeme Souness?
Oh, he'd be all over it.
Terry Butcher
would be a TikTok superstar.
You think he would be?
I think he would be,
Henrik Larsson,
sticking his tongue out on TikTok. Do the Henrik Larsson TikTok tongue. The TikTok tongue. He'd have been doing
Henrik
that.
Larsson. You know, John Robertson, Hearts legend. Gary Mackay, Hearts captain. Craig Levein.
Right.
I mean, you think he's some of the... Willie Miller, Alex McLeish. Can you imagine any of those star footballers standing on TikTok doing stupid dances?
It's something I would want to see. It's something I would want to see.
You wouldn't?
The whole Aberdeen-Gothenburg squad doing a dance after beating Real Madrid in the
final.
There
is only one superstar player from the past that I could see doing it.
And that is?
Gazza.
Probably.
Probably Gazza, because he's such a character and such a personality. He's the only person I could think of that would probably get involved with TikTok. I couldn't see anyone else in that era doing it. Can you think of any other player from that era? The 80s and 90s.
Diego Maradona.
Nah, he wouldn't have done. Do you think he'd done TikTok?
Aye.
You think so?
Yeah.
Pelly, wouldn't he?
Chris Waddle.
Chris Waddle. Well, he did Northern Lights, didn't he? He did that song Northern Lights. He did a bit of singing and dancing.
Glenn Hoddle. Yeah, exactly.
Glenn Hoddle as
they
well.
They could have been TikTok music superstars.
Uh-huh.
Like, what's his name? Nathan Evans.
Gary Lineker, can you see it?
No. Right, that's your nomination. Footballers doing TikTok videos of any form on any country.
Yeah.
Are they going in the bin? It's all down to you. You can vote on @BigFootballScott. And you can follow us there on Twitter. You can search for the Big Scottish Football Podcast on Facebook and Instagram as well. And you can see our lovely faces on YouTube.
Am I too old to do TikTok?
Yes.
Am I too old to watch TikTok?
Just go to the Clyde One Super Scoreboard YouTube channel and you can leave your comments there and you can have your say on footballers on TikTok. I think you are too old to TikTok.
And watch TikTok.
I don't have TikTok. I've not even engaged.
Are you too old to flick through and watch the videos?
Not interested.
Because I got a brilliant recipe for stir-fried beef on TikTok.
You can get that on Facebook and Instagram.
Yeah, I know, but I found it on TikTok. Yeah. It was an easy recipe to follow.
A wee reminder, Clyde One Super Scoreboard on the air every single night this week from 6 p.m, taking your calls. And obviously, it is building up to the big one on Sunday, 01419511025. Gordon Duncan at the helm, obviously. And on Saturday, I will not be on with former Hibs and Aberdeen striker Steve Cowan alongside you and Cameron for the big Saturday football show on 4th1 West FM, TFM, MFR, and NORTHSOUND, because I'll be on holiday. But you can still listen. Don't let that put you off. Right, okay, it's time to phone our favourite man in the world.
I can't phone him on Easter Monday.
How not? Yes, we can. Give me the chat.
Oh, I think that's bang out of order.
Do you not want to phone him?
I think on Easter Monday, you don't like disturb him, do you? I genuinely don't think we should disturb him on Easter Monday.
Do you not?
If you haven't phoned up yet, Scott, have
not,
you?
Not a Jose Easter message.
No, I think it's bang out of... No, don't phone him.
Okay. We're not phoning Jose.
I wouldn't phone Jose this week. I just think it's Easter weekend. People are on holiday. He's on holiday. He's probably spending some time with his family. He's probably looking in the mirror, kissing himself.
Yeah.
I genuinely wouldn't phone him today.
Okay, right. We won't phone Jose. So play the chant again and we'll then go into our next thing.
Yeah, I think that's the right thing. Just be nice. Jose. Love you, Jose. Yeah. Have a lovely Easter weekend, buddy.
No Easter. No. Jose message. Right, time for Scottish football's even greater hardest question. Here it is. The answer is inside this. And give me some question time music, please. It is. What is the connection between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres? Ramos DE67 say, I say what links Malpass and Torres as they both have the same amount of caps for their respective countries. Just a guess. John Lowe says, Malpass, last European game, Torres was on the bench for the opposition and came on as a substitute. That's from John Lowe. Smiley Face says, Torres won 110 caps for Spain. And Malpass half that was 55. Keep the question time music. I like it. I like the pianos. And Malpass won half that, 55 for Scotland. However, they both captained their national side twice. Brian says they both hate that Fudd's film reviews and think he's an utter tit. That's from Brian.
What's that got to do with the hardest ever scored?
I don't know.
He had actual dig at me for the hardest ever question.
Jamie says, do they both eat sausage rolls in the bath? John Mitchell says, Malpass used to babysit Torres when his mom went to the bingo. Jerry says, Fernando Torres and Morris Malpass both have won the UEFA Super Cup. Malpass in 1983 with Dundee United and Torres with Liverpool in 2005. That's obviously incorrect because Dundee United have not won the Super Cup. That was Aberdeen that won the Super Cup. But I can tell you that somebody has the right answer.
No way!
Somebody has solved it.
I wasn't expecting that.
Somebody has solved it. So you and Cameron, you can unseal.
So out of what you've just read, somebody got it?
Somebody has.
I was the listening, so I don't know what it is.
So this is interesting. What is the connection between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres? We finally have an answer. What is the date on it again? It was the 26th of February.
Yeah, what's the date today?
It's the 1st of April today. So it's gone into 2 months. So Ewen, you have the question and answer there. Okay. It's just one sheet.
Okay. The question was, what is the connection between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres? And the answer is... It's more than that, is it not?
No.
For Malpass? Are you sure?
Mm-hmm.
Signed by Stephen Mill, 26-2-24. The answer is, they both captained their national teams twice.
So, smiley face, you got the correct answer.
Well done, smiley face.
Well done, smiley face. Well done, smiley face. Both captained their national side twice. I told you it wasn't complicated.
I actually thought the Malpass maybe captained us a wee bit more than that.
No, it was twice.
Who was the captain at Dundee United? Was it not him for a while? Was he not captain at Dundee United?
Who? Malpass?
Malpass. He's not like captain at Dundee United for a while.
Yeah, but
I thought he also Scotland. I know, but I thought he took it to Scotland as well.
Was it not like Roy Aitken was kicking about? Soonest would have been kicking about. Yeah,
that's a good one. Not like that.
Paul McStay would have been the captain for quite a long time as well. I'd imagine.
That's good.
Well done, smiley face.
Well done, smiley.
We will be back in a couple of weeks' time.
Yeah, because I'm not doing one.
Scottish football's even greater. Harder, hardest question. But it's time for
No, it's not.
Hard questions of our own. Do you want another pen, Ewen?
My pen keeps breaking.
Right, I've got you another pen. There you are.
See, before we go any further, I'm just sick of it. The people are sending me pictures of them in the bath eating. Stop it.
Yeah, don't do that.
Right, stop sending me pictures.
Stop sending pictures of yourself in the bath eating to you and Cameron. Don't do that.
And another thing as well, though, one of the biggest regrets of doing this podcast was the day when I admitted that I struggle to cook rice.
Yes.
I am still getting slagged off for that. Yes. I'm still getting picked up about that. People are sending me links to rice cookers from Amazon.
You should just get one. Because you clearly still can't do it.
Everybody thinks they're also amazing and brilliant because they can cook rice. Prove that you can cook rice.
No, because then we'll just get people sending us rice and we don't want that.
But rice isn't as easy to cook as a lot of people seem to make out.
Really easy.
It's not. Stop having a pop at me in regards to rice and stop sending me pictures of rice cookers and stop sending me pictures of you lot eating in the bath or descriptions of what you're eating in the bath. It's just bogging and it's minging. Okay. I like what I like and when I do it, I don't mind it. It's like you don't mind the smell of your own farts, but you don't like anybody else's. You don't mind your own smell, your own smells. See, your own smell, you don't mind it.
Ewen.
See, when you make a smell of anything, you don't mind your own smell. But if you were to smell it of somebody else, you don't like it. And that's my point.
I preferred it when you were out just picking up random dog shit. That's better than this chat.
But that's my point. I don't mind eating in the bath, but I don't see any other bugger day in it.
Right, play the quiz music, Scott. Play the quiz music. Right. Time for the shootout quiz. It's 5 questions. I get football questions. Ewan gets film questions, even though it hasn't helped him in any way, shape or form.
And producer John will make a decision in the last 2 weeks quizzes when he gets back.
So it's 5 questions each taking it in turn. And I saw lots of people, because you stormed out again last week, calling you Spewing Cameron. It's like,
yeah, that's so funny. It's and original, great. Isn't it?
Yeah, Spewing Cameron. Yeah. So hopefully you're not Spewing Cameron today.
Just get on with it.
What do you mean?
Get on with it. So it's 5 questions each, like a penalty shootout.
I've said
at any point, you can do the bonus thing, which is top bin, worth 2 points.
Worth 2 points. And you're getting your Easter ones, your film ones, and I'm getting the football ones.
Yeah, go on.
Call it
tails.
It's heads. So I'll go first.
Go on then.
Producer Scott, hello.
Hello,
quizmaster.
Hello.
How are you doing? You're right. I'm good, yes.
Who put the questions together for today?
It was me. I've come up with an Easter special. So you'll get Easter film-related questions and Stephen will get football film-related questions. Sorry, football Easter-related questions.
Wait. Easter-related movie questions?
Yes.
Right, it's me to go first with the football one. Give me some tension, please. Give me some tension. Come on, here we go. Oh, a reminder, Scott, actually. We've put a 1 minute time limit on it.
Got it, don't worry.
You got it. Okay, that's fine. So it applies to both me and for Ewen. So I'm ready for question number one. Take it away, Scott.
Okay, question number one for you, Stephen. What year did Philip Lam win the World Cup?
Oh, that's so...
So I've got a minute to think about this.
Oh, just give him the answer. Even I know the answer to that. Oh, shad the football questions.
Well, Philip Lahm, he was German. And that means that he won the World Cup in 2014. And that's my final answer, Scott.
Well done.
Easy. There we go.
It's like just giving him the point. It's like having a having a penalty kick with a goalkeeper. Go on.
Right, Ewan. Here we go.
Easter-related movie question.
Yes.
Fuck's sake.
Yes.
Go on.
You've got this. I the tiger.
Don't you start with the pish chat, right? You just ask the questions. Don't.
I the tiger.
He's been sarcastic because that's my line.
Stop being spewing, Cameron. Come on.
What is Charlie's surname in Charlie and the Chocolate
Bucket
Factory?
Final answer.
Say that again for me.
Bucket.
Didn't even have to put the buzzer on.
No.
There you go.
So are you complaining about that question?
It's a great question.
Right.
1-1.
Okay. Stephen, which English Premier League team did Chelsea sign Victor Moses from?
So easy!
Is it?
Aye!
Is Victor Moses at Chelsea?
What do you mean?
Like now? Is he not playing in like Italy or something? Moses.
Well, he was at Chelsea though.
I believe he's at Spartak.
Right,
Scott. At the moment.
Scott, right? Don't do a John Mack here. You ask the question.
I genuinely
and shut your face.
I genuinely do not know the answer to this question.
I do.
So I'm going to have to guess.
Are you?
Yeah.
How long's left in the timer?
30 seconds.
I've written it down.
Right. And what have you written down?
Really?
So, did he go from like Chelsea to Everton? And then like go to like... I'm so confused.
Bear in mind,
I'm going to go
for... The question is, who did Chelsea sign him from?
Crystal Palace, final answer.
Just going to let that. It's not. Ewan, who do you think it was?
Wigan.
Correct, it was Wigan Athletic.
I would never have got that in a million years.
Give me my Easter-related movie question, go 2-1 up.
Sure. General Woundwort is an evil bunny rabbit in which movie?
What? Why are you laughing? Who's General Woundwort? What? Say that again.
General Woundwort is an evil bunny rabbit in which movie?
General Woundwort.
Woundwort.
Wound.
Yes.
Woundwort, as in W-O-U-N-D wart, W-A-R-T.
Pretty much, yes.
Woundwort.
It's an evil bunny rabbit in which movie?
Is it Alice in Wonderland? The bunny rabbits in Alice in Wonderland aren't evil, are they? Woundwort.
Woundwort, yeah.
Is it something to do with the guy who had the wrong trousers? Wallace and Gromit.
Ewan, you're running out of time.
Is it Wallace and Gromit? Because there was rabbit in Wallace and... Shut up, you! I'm... Woundwort!
Right.
I'm going to go final answer, Alice in Wonderland. Woundwort!
Stephen, did you know the answer to that one?
No.
The answer was Watership Down.
A very famous rabbit movie.
Bright eyes... Burns like fire. The rabbit dies at the end.
Stop spoiling films for people.
Oh, yeah.
Right, question number three,
sad.
Scott.
Okay, question number three for you. Who scored more goals for Argentina, Sergio Aguero or Carlos Tevez?
He's got a 50-50, what's that like?
Aye, but you might get one.
I've got no idea. So I'm just going to have to guess. I don't know if the Tevez... Did Aguero play loads?
Was Aguero on the bench a lot?
Yeah. I think I'm going to go for Carlos Tevez. Final answer.
It's actually nowhere near, so Aguero had 41 to Tevez's 13.
Jesus Christ.
I would have guessed that Aguero spent most of his time on the bench at Argentina. I don't remember him playing that many games.
Oh, right.
Anyway, back to still 1-1, question 3 for me.
Yep. So, Ewen, in Monty Python's Life of Brian,
yeah,
which Python says, he's not the Messiah, he's a very naughty boy?
Where's my 50-50?
Well, it's near enough a 50-50. It's Monty Python. Everybody knows who Monty Python are.
Yeah, I know, but there's like 7 of them.
Aye.
Oh,
it's a film quiz. You're the film expert. One of the most famous films ever, Life of Brian.
Well, it's not John Cleese. It's not Michael Palin. It's Brian something. Can I just give the name Brian?
No.
No, it's not Brian. It's a guy with the moustache and the beard. Oh, no, it's not. What was the line again?
He's not the Messiah. He's a very naughty boy.
Yeah, hangs out the windy and dark hair.
Ah, I can see him!
I'm going to kick myself because I just listened to a podcast with John Cleese talking about it with Bill Mayer.
Time's almost up.
Real time with Bill Mayer. Oh, John Cleese, final answer. It's fucking no him, though.
John Cleese.
It's not him.
It's not, no. The answer is Terry Jones.
Terry Jones!
That's bad. Right, next question. 1-1 on question 4.
Yep. Shit. So, question 4 for you, Stephen. How many Scottish football teams has Andy Bank Halliday played for in his career? How many Scottish football teams?
Okay.
Timer!
That coffee stain's doing my nothing. That's going to ruin my jumper.
Livingston. Hearts.
Did Andy Halliday play for Livingston?
Yeah.
Did he?
Rangers.
I didn't know that.
Motherwell. Is there another one? I see like Hamilton.
Andy Halliday was at Livingston?
Aye.
In the Premier League?
Don't think so. Well, maybe when they first got promoted. I'm not sure. Got no idea. Right, I've got 4. But
that stain's doing my nothing.
He's maybe been on loan somewhere else. So I will say final answer.
Ah!
I don't know. Final answer.
Go on.
Time's almost up.
5. Final answer.
5. Should have gone with your working. It was 4.
What? You said 4? You wrote down 4. Why did you not stick with 4?
Because I thought there was maybe another one. He was on loan or something when he was young or something like that.
Get 10!
Right, 1-1. Question 4 for me.
Ah!
Cool. Ewan, in The Night at the Museum.
Yes?
What item does the Easter Island statue ask Ben Stiller's caretaker for?
What kind of question is that? Read that again to me.
In The Night at the Museum, what item does the Easter Island statue ask Ben Stiller's caretaker for?
I mean, if you've seen The Night at the Museum, you'll know it.
It's a great film. They're all wee and everything. It's brilliant, all come to life. What item did he ask him for? They asked for the Scroll of Independence. Is that what you asked him for? Why is that? Why would I think that?
Got about 20 seconds left.
All right, okay, I can see that. Right, I'm going to go for the Scroll of Independence final answer.
Okay. Stephen, do you know it by chance?
No, I don't. Nope. No.
So he asks Ben Stiller's caretaker for gum. He says, "Dum dum, give me gum gum."
This is the worst quiz ever. This is the worst quiz ever.
Amazing.
We're at 1-1 going into question 5 and we're at sudden death.
Right. Let's go.
You're going to go for the normal?
Just normal. Normal.
Oh, no, these are normal questions because it's question 5. Go.
Okay. I know, but I could have gone top in.
Oh, well, why don't you?
Because I don't want to.
Oh, okay.
Okay, Stephen. Excelsior are a football team that play in which European country?
Oh, piss off. I mean, piss off. If I get another question with gum gum and dum dum, when he gets that, I will rip this place apart. Oh. I will destroy this place. I will destroy this place like the end of a rock concert. I'm going to bash it up. That screen's coming off the wall. You better not screw me up here with some pishy question with gum gum dum dum.
I don't know.
Oh, shut up! Of course you know.
No, I do. The answer is the Netherlands. Final answer.
Oh, I'm telling you right now.
Is the Netherlands well done, Stephen?
Honestly, I'm going to rip this place apart.
How?
Fuck. Right, go on. If you screw me over here, Scott.
Do you want to go normal or do you want to go top in?
Of course I'm going to go normal.
Okay, cool. Remember, it's Easter themed. Give me the name of the 1980 British gangster film starring Bob Hoskins and Helen Mirren.
Timer, please.
The Good Friday, final answer.
The Good Friday.
Final answer.
I'm so sorry. It's called The Long Good Friday.
You can't moan about that. It's not, you gave the wrong answer.
I didn't.
You did. You missed out a word.
I'm so sorry, Ewen.
You missed out a word. You missed out a word. Champions League. You know it. You know it. Champions League music for me, please. Yet another win on the quiz. You know it. You know it. You know it. You know it. Great times. Yet another victory. Thanks to everyone for all the support as per usual.
Fucking
on the quiz.
Easter's ruined.
And
Easter's ruined.
You've also ruined Easter for you and Cameron as well. Stop chucking things at me. It's your fault.
I hope there's a tornado in Atlanta when you go.
I don't think they get tornadoes in Atlanta. I think it's more sort
that's
of
what I get for an Easter egg.
More in the sort of Midwest, sort of Oklahoma style. Right, anyway, hit the music, Scott. Thank you very much. This has been the Big Scottish Football Podcast, and thank you so much for listening. That's Spew and Cameron away. Another victory in the quiz for me, which is great. I'm not going to be here next week, but you can still get in touch for Scottish Football in the Bin. You can have your vote on that, which is, of course, football players on TikTok. So get in touch there for that. I will have a new Scottish Football's Even Greater Hardest Question in a couple of weeks' time. Well done to Smiley Face for getting it right again. The answer, of course, was, in case you missed it, what's the connection between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres? They have both captained their national team twice. There we go. So that is it from me. Ewen Cameron will be back next week alongside Christian Titz, who will be our co-host. So enjoy your week, and I'll see you in a few weeks' time. All the best. Bye-bye. Bye.